tell me about the first time you heard of or heard Bette Davis.
The first time I heard of Bette Davis, it was in college, and I was in a class that was about Miles Davis, and we were reading his autobiography. And it was like, I got to the page where he was describing meeting her and how basically from that point on, how she influenced his fashion, his art. And kind of at that point, even though it was an assignment, I kind of like put the book down and I was just like Googling all about Bette Davis and like discovered her music and was listening to it. And I loved just looking at her pictures. I had recently like cut off my perm like around that time. So I was just like very inspired by her imagery and also her music. And then from then on, I was just kind of obsessively trying to find whatever I could because there's not very many, or at least at that time, there weren't very many interviews. So I was just listening and reading whatever I could find until more recently when there's like the documentary and things that have allowed me to learn more.
Yeah, I mean, she is such a mystery to so many people. And again, like in the last few years, there has been a resurgence a bit where her music has been used in movies and TV shows. She's done some reissues and you know, has kind of reemerged for the documentary and different interviews. But at that time, like what were the resources you were going to? Because a lot of that privacy was her choice to leave behind the industry that was not treating her very well, and also for a lot of personal reasons. But what were the resources that kind of helped you learn about her at that time?
At that time, it was really listening to her music and also just kind of absorbing the way that she created her own image and kind of just understanding, like, because sometimes, you know, you look at artist's image, you can't assume that it was their full creative direction, but kind of just knowing that for her, like, the fashion and everything was like an extension of her art. That was really striking to me. And there was one like recorded interview that I listened to. And I think later on when I was working on my album Legacy, I became really obsessed with like interviews by Black artists. And this one was really intriguing to me because she would just answer sometimes like no. She would just have like one word answers to things, and like it didn't seem like it just seemed like a human boundary that she wasn't willing to cross for the sake of press or, you know, something. It just was really inspiring to me. It struck me in that moment, and then later on as I became an artist who has to navigate those things, it just, I would always think back to that, like you can have your own sort of protected space of things that are just for you.
And she was always so amazing at really asserting her own influence on other people. Like I read this really great interview that she had done that I had never seen before, and someone had posted it on Instagram a couple months ago, and where she was like, you know, like a lot of stuff that's happening in disco, like Donna Summer would not exist without me. And she was talking about like, yeah, I love Stevie Wonder, but like we just like would not, he would not be on the same level as me when in the studio, like we would be doing two different things. Like, tell me about kind of engaging with that type of confidence, especially for how we view Black women in music, especially at the time that she was existing in the 70s, like the idea of being able to kind of assert yourself in that way, still hard for women in music, for Black women in music, but especially then. Tell me about kind of reading and seeing that type of confidence from her as an artist.
That was probably one of the most inspiring parts about her story that I really latched onto over the process of creating my past project. Because I think I was thinking a lot about just like the balance of feminine masculine energy in myself and how I think the ways that I naturally am, like being in the industry that I am, it asked me to step outside of that a lot. And I was trying to navigate that. And so I really, when I saw the documentary, it was like midway through creating the album, and just the part where they were talking about how she knew exactly how she wanted her album to sound. Like she had the whole vision, and it wasn't just, it was that her music, you know, and her subject matter and her image was like ahead of her time, but it was also that she was like, she would talk about like, I just talk aggressively and I know what I want, and men don't like that. They like for women to be submissive, and just the way that she wouldn't compromise on that was really, really inspiring to me. And also the way she had multitudes, you know, because she would kind of say like, I'd be out clubbing, but I wouldn't drink and I would go home and I like to be by myself. So like, I like that sort of way where like you can call upon, you can like manifest that energy when you need it, but you can also be lots of different ways in different spaces. That was really inspiring to me.
Yeah. And let's get into the music itself too. I mean, tell me about those early listening experiences of digging into her discography. And there is, you know, it does feel like so little and you like want so much more, especially when I was first starting to listen to her. I was like, I wish I had like 20 Bette Davis albums to dig into, but tell me about some of your favorites and, you know, what was the entry point for listening to the music?
Yeah, I think my favorite song that I always instantly gravitated to and love is the Anti-Love song. Like, I remember listening to that, like, no, I don't want to love you. Like, just what an opening line for a song. And just like the ways that she would be talking about love or sex or just like kind of broad topics in a way that was like, you felt like you were hearing from like an auntie or like sister or something. Like, it felt very intimate and very specific. And her voice, the sound of her voice, because I think a lot of times growing up, I would be kind of comparing myself to, do I have these certain things? Like, can I achieve these sort of athletic things about singing? And it took me a long time to kind of recognize like what I have as opposed to thinking about what I lack, and instantly being struck by just the sonic quality of her voice. It's like she makes me want to listen to what she's saying, and I don't think I understood the power of just that for a long time, and she really helped me internalize that.
Yeah, I mean, her, you know, there's not a lot of video of her performing, and it's, you know, all the reviews are kind of like, her on stage is so transformative, and it's like, I wish I could see this, but I feel like you can so much hear that in her voice, like how it would sound live, because she has such like this raw way of singing. And can you talk a little bit about the emotiveness of the vocal performance on the album specifically?
Yeah, I think that makes me think a lot about this idea of like not having perfection be a barometer, but more having like authenticity and emotion as like the barometer. And I think that, yeah, just listening to her records, like you said, it's like this raw emotion that makes you believe what she's saying. And that is what makes me feel what she's saying, you know? And I think that's really like a good lesson as an artist too, because I think I can get really caught up in like, oh, did I hit the note? Or like, is that stack perfect? Or like these little things, versus almost to the point where I forget, like, why did I even write the song? Or what am I feeling while I'm saying these words that I wrote? And yeah, I think that, and even just like the way you can get like sensual, like energy, she's like transmuting energy through her voice too, which I think is really powerful. Yeah.
And for those that are gonna be reading this and seeing this video and not really knowing much about Bette and her impact, can you talk to us a little bit about the Miles Davis connection and the influence that she had on him, as well as some of the other artists that she was mingling with at the time in the late 60s, 70s, and where her influence and energy kind of spread in that moment?
Yeah, what I remember about her relationship with Miles Davis, like, she introduced him to Jimi Hendrix, and so it kind of changed his trajectory to go towards the more like psychedelic rock area, and also his fashion. Like, you could just literally look at pictures and she was styling him. He was wearing like flare pants and like more colors and things after like the whole more like restricted, like cool phase. So there's that musically, kind of like expanding and really being his muse too. People say like Bitches Brew, like she told him to change the title, and like people say like that album is like kind of inspired by her in some ways. But there's that, and then, you know, she's close friends with Jimi Hendrix, and I really think I guess also she was friends with Eric Clapton or had some type of relationship with him, but was like, I won't collaborate with you because like your music's kind of boring, or like however she said it. So I also like to kind of just imagine like who all, like we know some things about her network, but I like just that Eric Clapton was so random to me that I'm like, I can't imagine like who else she had relationships with and like the way she might have influenced others that we don't know in such an explicit way.
Yeah. And you mentioned a little bit earlier about sort of what she taught you about those boundaries, especially in interviews and kind of the private and the public life separation. And especially you've seen the documentary and, you know, what do you kind of remember from it and learned about why she left music and why she sort of so early in her career, while she still had so many people left to discover her, like what kind of left, what made for that exit so seemingly early from everything?
Yeah, I think one of the things I loved about the documentary was how, like, I think I remember in a conversation after the director was saying, like, we didn't want to make it like such a traditional music documentary where it's like all about facts. We also wanted you to kind of like feel a little like impressionistically, like what it was like to be her. And so I think from my feeling, it felt like this feeling of kind of, she was describing making her last album that she was working on and having all of those ideas herself and having them be shut down, whether it was by like Miles wanting to do stuff his way or the people at the label, people telling her to change her image or tone down the sexuality. And she would also say like, she wasn't writing about sex, like in her music, she wasn't like, I sat down to write about sex. It was like, she sat down to write music. And it was like, you know, some songs inspired by her friends, sometimes just working from this really authentic place. So it's interesting to me because so often now it's like that sexuality, especially with Black women's sexuality, is so commodified. And so she's like ahead of that in so many ways where it's like being rejected because it's seeming like too much. But it seemed like that not being accepted, being able to carve out that space for herself. And then also it seemed like there was like emotional, I remember some sort of death, like someone really close to her and her family passed away and she went to Japan and like had a lot of like spiritual experiences. And it kind of just seemed like that moment where you realize this path might be actually asking too much for you to like put too many parts of yourself to the side to fit into what this path is asking. And she kind of just chose another path of just like being more off the grid. And I thought too that in the process of her deciding to open back up to the world and even do the documentary, that was also an example of really strong boundaries and also like her creative vision kind of being infused in the whole thing. And she was kind of saying, you know, I was like, should I do this? Should I not? But I decided it's better to do it when I'm alive and I can be a part of it and make sure that you get it right. And so much of the documentary is influenced by like her like imagery, like her own poetry and her own like journal writing. And it's also like she doesn't want her face to be shown. And so she kind of had that really hard boundary and kind of like wanted people to keep the image that they have of her. And she can keep, like, she's kind of like, I want to remain low key. Like, I don't really want you to see my face, which I think is really interesting, especially thinking about just the ways other stories can be told about artists when they don't get to participate and how that can limit how much we can acknowledge the human part of them.
Yeah. Where do you see the influence of Bette Davis today, whether people even realize it or not, that she has influenced us in both, not just your art, but also of your peers, of, you know, people that, other artists that you love? Where can we hear and see Bette Davis in 2021?
I think so many places, honestly. Like, I was thinking about that this morning, because it's not only, I think partially like the way that she sat within her genre. It was like funk music, but like really soulful, but almost like in the little clips that I do see, it has like really like rock like energy too. It's kind of like creating her own genre, especially when you think about the subject matters she was talking about. It's like that makes me think of so many artists who kind of bend in that way. Like, I know Erykah Badu was like a part of some of the documentary like conversations, but I love her and I think of her in a lot of similar ways and the way that her voice is so unique. But even just thinking about how so many artists, Black women artists, are in charge of their sexuality and their like sensuality and their expression, whether it's like Cardi B or Megan Thee Stallion or SZA, just like the way that it gives a certain freedom to be in control of how that narrative is shaped. And it's not about allowing it to be kind of commodified in a way, but more just saying, this is just a part of me and this is a part of my authentic expression. I think she really laid the groundwork for that in a lot of ways. And I know, I think Prince is another person that she's often saying that, like, he was really inspired by her. Could totally see that lineage too. It's just really inspiring how vast I think her kind of children are.
And finally, again, since she is someone that I think there are still so many people left to discover her and I hope discover her music and, you know, feel the same sort of drive that we both seem to have had when we first learned about her. But I mean, tell me about what you're hoping for the future of Bette Davis fandom in some ways and of people kind of learning retroactively about her music as she sort of opened up herself a bit more in terms of releasing a lot of the music we hadn't heard yet and doing, again, reissuing the albums, things like that. But what are you hoping people kind of learn and gain from discovering her in coming years?
I hope we can gain those lessons kind of that I've been talking about the commitment to your authentic self and to protecting the parts of yourself that are just for you, and understanding that you're allowed to have boundaries and allowed to have, you know, just respect for your humanity as an artist and also as a person in general. I think of the way that that viral clip of Eartha Kitt going to social media kind of, I think, awakened a lot of people to who is she? Like, or even if I don't know who she is, like, she gave me this message about love that I needed. And I feel like, I think that's what I hope for Bette Davis, is that she becomes kind of like this name that, you know, whether or not the masses know everything, cool, but especially for Black people, Black women, to have her as kind of this emblem of those lessons would be a really cool thing to me.